just gander outside, look at the beautiful sun illuminating the trees that God has decorated so beautifully for all of us. So help us to celebrate this day. We are glad you're here. We welcome those who are worshiping online. Before church started, we lit a couple of candles. We would invite you to light a candle at home if you're worshiping on live stream. The first candle is, of course, the Jesus Christ candle. It reminds us of God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit here with us. And wherever we gather, two or more are gathered, He is present. So that helps us remember that. And we also have a social justice candle. We're going to hear from Nikki a little later in the service. We thank her for that. She's going to speak to us about domestic violence and gender-based violence. So that'll be very powerful to hear, I'm sure. So we thank you that you're here. We pray this worship time will be a blessing to you. And so we'll begin by joining our voices together, standing as able, and we'll sing with the praise band.
I'm going to go to the next one. grateful that God has gathered us together today. I'm Pastor Mary, grateful to be here worshiping with you here in the sanctuary and online as well. And we invite you, if you're joining us online, let us know that you're worshiping with us today. We're glad to be together by God's grace. We're grateful for a new day to remember God's faithfulness. And I always think of those words from Scripture that God's mercies are new every morning. And so we celebrate as we worship today. We've been focusing on discipleship in our current worship series, using our Wesleyan Methodist heritage as a lens to look through how we live out our faith today. And so today we'll focus on the gifts we have, each of us has, to share as disciples of Jesus. And we'll look at how those gifts come together as the body of Christ and all the connections that we have together and the blessings that that is as well. So invite you to open your hearts as we worship today. And I want to invite the kids to come forward as I share a couple of announcements and just some opportunities in our life together. They can come forward and at these front pews if they'd like. A reminder to send in your God moments. Write down your God moments or prayer requests if you have them. You can send them in if you're joining us online, office@lakeharborumc.org. We have an active prayer team and would be glad to share the prayers that you have. And the same is true for our God moments. We'll share those a little later in our service, but those are a blessing to us together. I want to remind you of our trunk or treat this afternoon, 3:30 to 5, here in our parking lot. It's going to be a wonderful day. It's not raining, so that's great. We're looking forward to lots of kids and families here and grateful to be able to offer a free event for our community. So join us for that. Even if you don't plan to have a trunk, just come and enjoy that time and offer a welcome to the people in our community who will be here. I want to invite you to be part of another opportunity to hear from missionaries in our larger church tomorrow night during our missions team meeting. We'll have Delbert and Sandy Groves here. They are missionaries in Zambia. And for those who might remember, a few years ago, we supported the construction of a new church building in Zambia. They were part of that. They were our connection there. And so they'll be here to share an update about that with us and to share about their ministry. So just as we were so blessed to have Dr. Tenba here a couple of weeks ago sharing about his work and the work of the church, we'll hear some more about that. It's a blessing to be able to have those connections. So I'd invite you to join us tomorrow night at 6 for that. Grief Care continues to meet Mondays at 6:30. There are opportunities for Bible study on Tuesday morning, Tuesday evening for our men's Bible study, and Saturday morning for our Saturday sisters' Bible study. So lots of opportunities to get connected. Our care team is meeting on Wednesday at 11. If you would like to be part of visiting our homebound members and friends and keeping connected, we'd invite you to be part of that. So you can join us for that meeting. We also have a prayer service here Wednesday night at 6, and particularly have some time to pray for our world and lift up the prayers of our hearts in a time when prayer can't be underestimated, and prayer also is the way that we can offer our hearts to God. So we invite you to be with us for that Wednesday night. Youth groups will also meet Wednesday night, and then next Sunday when we gather, October 29th, it will be a wonderful day of worship. A couple of things that are going to happen. First, we're going to celebrate All Saints Day and remember those who have passed away within the past year. So we'll read those names and pray. We'll also have an opportunity for all of us to offer our faith commitments for the coming year. And hopefully by now you've received a faith commitment card in the mail. If you haven't and need one, we have some here. But we hope you'll take time to pray and plan and make a commitment of prayers, presence, gift, service, and witness for the coming year. That's a blessing as we do ministry together. And we'll also receive new members next week. So it'll be a wonderful time of worship. We also have our charge conference next Sunday afternoon. We'll gather with others, other Muskegon friends at Community United Methodist Church in North Muskegon in the afternoon. To have some time together and to also do the business that we have to do together in preparation for another year of mission and ministry. So keep that in mind for next week, and a great blessing to be able to gather together and to share mission and ministry together. Okay, are you ready to say good morning? we're going to do some motions with our hands. And this is a song I learned a long time ago. Some people might know it. It's a pretty easy song. It won't be hard to learn. So join me if you can. First, I need you to make this motion. Like deep. Like the water's deep. Okay. And the water's wide. Anybody know what song we're going to sing? Deep and wide, my friends. Here we go. This is how it goes. If you know it, sing along with me. Deep and wide. Deep and wide, there's a fountain flowing deep and wide. Deep and wide, deep and wide, there's a fountain flowing deep and wide. And then you're supposed to do wide and deep and all that. We won't do all that today, but I want you to remember deep and wide. Thank you. Very good. Deep and wide. Okay. And anytime you hear me say those words today, do this. Deep. I'm going to say them a lot, not just in this time, but when we talk a little bit later, too. The reason we're talking about that song is because we're talking about how deep and wide God's love is for us, all right? And how we learn about how deep and wide God's love is being part of the church, of the faith community. Because I don't know if I would know how deep and wide God's love is without all the people around me in the church reminding me of that. So we're going to talk about all the gifts that we have to share and the ways that we can make sure that everybody around us knows how deep and wide God's love is. You got it. You're in it now. This is good. All right. So we're going to read from scripture from a letter that Paul wrote to the church early on when the church had just been kind of established, and he tells them to use the gifts they have to serve and to share, right? And so there's lots of different ways that different Bibles kind of share this, but I want to read you one of them today. If your gift is to speak God's message, you should do it according to the faith you have. If it's to serve, you should serve. If it's to teach, you should teach. If it's to encourage others, we should do that. Whoever shares with others should do it generously. Whoever has authority should work hard. Whoever shows kindness to others should do it cheerfully. So Paul wants them to use all the gifts they have, and not everybody has all the same gifts. We have different things that we're good at. Is anybody really good, or does anybody love to draw or color? Yeah. I have a drawer full of beautiful drawings and pictures that people have made for me. They brighten my day every time I look at them. Does anybody like to help? Like to help each other sometimes, right? Do you ever find it hard to share what you have? Yeah, sometimes it's hard, isn't it? But when we share, sometimes it feels really good to share. When it makes other people happy, it makes them be able to do the things they want to do. It's really good to share. So there's all these kinds of gifts that we have, whether it's singing, whether it's sharing, whether it's helping, whether it's serving, all those kinds of gifts. Paul says we should share those, we should use those gifts because that helps others know how deep and wide God's love is, right? So we're going to talk about that today, and I want you to think about all the gifts that you have. And maybe even, if you can, there are those prayer, the green slips or the blue slips in the pockets in front of you. You can feel free to write down a gift that you have and a gift that you can use to share God's love with other people. And you can put it in the offering plates at the back during our offering time, okay? So feel free to write it down and do that. That's a wonderful way that we can offer our gifts to God, okay? So let's pray this morning. God, thank you for these children. Thank you for all the gifts that you've given us. We know that your love is deeper and wider than we can even imagine. And that wherever your love is, there is life and hope and there is joy. So help us to remember that we're part of showing how deep and wide your love is when we share our gifts and show it to others. Help us do that wherever we are, whether at home, at school, wherever we find ourselves, we know that there's always an opportunity, always a chance for us to do that. Help us do it wherever we are. Be with us, be with all our children. We pray in the name of Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, and our friend. Amen. social justice issue that we focus on each month in prayer for sure, but also to raise our awareness of what is what we need to know and how we can be even more helpful in prayer and advocacy. So I'm grateful that Nikki is here today to share about this month's social justice issue.
Thank you. Like she just mentioned, my name is Nikki Uplett, and good morning, everyone. I wanted to share some information about domestic violence. October was first declared as Domestic Violence Awareness Month in 1989. Since then, October has been a time to acknowledge domestic violence survivors and be a voice for its victims. Domestic violence is prevalent in every community and affects all people, regardless of age, socioeconomical status, sexual orientation, gender, race, religion, or nationality. Physical violence is often accompanied by emotionally abusive and controlling behavior as a part of a much larger systemic pattern of dominance and control. Domestic violence can result in physical injury, psychological trauma, and even death. The devastating consequences of domestic violence can cross generations and last a lifetime. Although there's been a substantial progress in reducing domestic violence, on average, 20 people are physically abused by intimate partners every minute. This equates to more than 10 million abuse victims annually. One in three women and one in four men have been physically abused by an intimate partner. Millions of Americans live in daily silent fear within their own homes. In addition, every year, millions of children are exposed to domestic violence. Domestic violence incidents affects every person within a home and can have long-lasting negative effects on children's emotional well-being and social and academic functioning. Victims don't need to suffer in silence, though. There are resources available to help right here in our community. One of them is an organization called Every Woman's Place, and it can be found at everywomansplace.org. They also have a 24-hour crisis line, and you can also text and chat with them online. So there is help available in our community, and I'm more than willing and welcome to talk with anyone about that. Thank you.
Thanks, Nikki, for sharing with us. I'm grateful that we continue to have those different focus points each month and raise our awareness and offer both our prayers and our commitment to act on behalf of those in need. I want to invite Rose forward to continue to share with us this morning.
We're just going to take a minute. Thank you, Nikki, for sharing your words of wisdom. And we want to acknowledge that this is the time for God moments, the time that we share God moments that were sent in from last week. I encourage you to share your own God moments, either on paper or send them in to us at lakeharborumc.org. These are powerful witnesses to how God is really present in our everyday lives. So let's take a minute and look at the God moments that were sent this past week. And I'll close this in a centering prayer.
Thank you.
join me in prayer. Good morning, Abba Father. We rejoice with the gift of another day. The glorious colors of fall delight all our senses, and we thank you. Your generous hands bless us so richly, Father. But may we also remember those who do not live in a life of plenty. Help us to have hearts that long to share all we have with those in need. May we strive to fight the evil that is so prevalent in our world today. Guide us to bind our hearts with other brothers and sisters in Christ to build your kingdom here. Forgive us when we falter and turn a deaf ear to your truth. Help us to love all your beloved children. It's in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. It is now a time for offering. There are offering trays in the back of the church if you're willing to offer a financial gift. Remember that your talents, your gifts that God has given you, and each one of us has something that he's gifted us with. Those are ways we can be an offering to God. In return for all the love he's given us, remember to offer those things as well from your heart. And remember that we have noisy offering buckets as well. Those this month, as Pastor Mary said, will go to Kids Belong First Place. We're privileged to help support that organization, so please be generous there. And please offer your voices in song and praise as we sing along with the praise band. Please stand as able.
Thank you.
together in love, to learn, to find healing, to grow, and to serve. Hear our prayers as we offer our gifts as an act of worship, with thanksgiving for your goodness and your grace. Be with us today. Open our hearts to the reading and hearing and understanding and living of your word. Guide us, we pray, by your Spirit. Amen. I invite you to hear with me these words from Romans chapter 12, beginning with verse 3. The theme is humble service in the body of Christ. Hear these words. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. One more time, just for everybody to remember. Deep and wide, deep and wide, there's a fountain flowing deep and wide. Deep and wide, deep and wide, there's a fountain flowing deep and wide. Now, I learned that song early on, maybe you did too, but it came to me as I thought about how we live together as the church here at Lake Harbor, how we're connected to other churches, whether they're United Methodist churches in our community or around the world, or other denominations, other Christians around the world. And I want to be clear that we're connected to everyone who follows Jesus. There's that song that maybe you've heard too. All who follow Jesus all around the world. Yes, we're the church together. We have differences in theology to be sure, but in the essentials, we have unity as we follow Jesus as Lord and Savior. Still in our United Methodist tradition, our roots run deep and our reach is wide. I've always appreciated how the United Methodist Church has grown along with the United States as a country. With growth, there's always navigating challenges and changes. Now, you might remember that the Methodist movement began in England in the 1730s when John and Charles Wesley started a holy club at Oxford and encouraged a revival of faith in the Anglican Church. Their motivation was not to start a new denomination, it was to revive what was already there. And yet, as the movement grew, they also saw a need to spread good news across the Atlantic Ocean, and so they sent people, and the movement grew here. And soon enough, there was a need for some organization, and so Methodist preachers gathered in Baltimore, Maryland, for what's known as the Christmas Conference on Christmas Eve, 1784. I do not know how they got pastors to go gather together on Christmas Eve in 1784, but they did it. They called them all to Baltimore, and so that's become sort of the establishment of the church in America. It was established in the newly found country. It continued to grow as the country grew, expanding to every corner of the country, which is why you'll find Methodists in every area. If you've traveled at all, even outside of Muskegon, in any other state around the country, there are United Methodist churches in every area. That's a blessing if you're traveling and you see the familiar sign of the cross and flame. I've worshipped in other states. Maybe you have too. We've had people who vacationed at the lake worship with us here. When my mom and I needed a copy of something for my uncle last summer when we were in Idaho, my first thought was, well, where's the nearest church? Maybe I can do that. And so I looked it up, and it was right around the corner from the care facility where he lived. And so we went and knocked on the door, and the office assistant there helped us with what we needed. It was wonderful and amazing to have that connection. And we've benefited from that in many ways. Our youth group has stayed in different Methodist churches, United Methodist churches around the country on their mission trips, and so many other wonderful blessings of the connection. From the beginning of our faith ancestors in Scripture, the faith story that we claim, to the coming of Christ, to the early church that Paul writes to in Rome, to the Protestant movement in the 1500s, to the Anglican church, and then the Methodist, we're here by God's grace first and foremost. But grace that worked through the faith and tenacity and passion of those who have come before us. Our roots are deep and our reach is wide. So we're in week 10 of our series of these United Methodist 10, and I want to share a breakdown of our church structure. And before you tune out, it's really interesting, I promise. It's borrowed from Reverend Jeremy Smith. It's interesting to look at these parts of the church structure. So there are seven parts of the church structure and three connections that we have around the world. So we'll look at the seven quickly. The local church. That's who we are together, the local church. Charge conference is there because charge conference is the yearly meeting that we have to do the business that we have to do. That's next week if you want to join us at Community United Methodist Church. But this is how we organize ourselves, the local church. And the local church is the most important foundational piece of how the church functions. That's where it starts. It doesn't start from the top down, but from the bottom. The bottom, the foundational pieces. From there, we go to the city or town or the area that we're in. And for us, that's Muskegon. Muskegon Methodist Ministries has been organized for years in important ministries like Mission for Area People and Supper House and Family Promise of the Lakeshore have been supported by Muskegon Methodist Ministries. I would even say that some of them probably wouldn't exist without the work and connection of Muskegon Methodist Ministries, particularly Mission for Area People that started out of MMM's work together. From there, we go to the district, a little wider. And our district right now, we're in the Western Waters District, which stretches from the top of the tip of the lower peninsula almost down to past Holland. So a number of churches overseen by our district superintendent connected on that west coast of the lower peninsula. From there, we have the regional, our regional area, the network of the annual conference. All of Michigan is in one conference. So we have a bishop, Bishop David Bard, who is our spiritual leader for the annual conference. And we're connected to all the other churches in Michigan. From there, we go to the jurisdictional conference, which is sort of the Midwest area. We're in the North Central jurisdiction. And the main work of the jurisdiction is to elect bishops every 4 years. Bishop Bard actually comes from Minnesota. He was elected as part of our jurisdiction and then appointed to serve here in Michigan. Then we have affiliation networks and the global network of the general agencies of the church and the Association of Theological Schools. The seminary where I attended is part of that. So we kind of go from the local church to this wide global network. One person said it this way, the United Methodist Church structure is like a pebble dropped in still water with concentric rings embracing more and more churches and people. Again, the roots are deep, the reaches are wide. And another blessing is that we can do more together than we could do alone. We've seen that when we've talked about missionary work, the missionaries who visited us as part of the General Board of Global Ministries. They're supported by many churches, not just one. We can do more together than we could ever do alone. The work of UNCOR, the United Methodist Committee on Relief, is a wonderful example of that. It goes for us as the church. It goes for us as disciples, too, and for us as a community of faith. To go along with those seven levels of that connection, there are three branches of our global connection. And you might notice right away that these sort of mirror how our government is structured. The structure is similar to those branches, legislative, executive, and judicial. The duties of the church governance are divided into those three branches. So the General Conference is the legislative branch to create doctrine and polity every 4 years. The bishops and the general agency are the executive branch. They put into action what the General Conference votes on. And then the Judicial Council ensures that everything is followed in those doctrines and decisions. So the hope is the same, that there's no one person or group in charge, but that all the branches work together and are elected by and have representation from the larger church. And by the way, it's important to know that there are clergy and laity involved at every level of these. That's always been important, that there's an equal number of clergy and lay people making decisions together. We started this series with a focus on our mission, to go and make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. Now, that mission is for the whole church, but we also have to be clear that the local church is the most significant and important place where disciple-making happens. The local church and ministries involved in the local church, campus ministries, chaplaincy work, all of those are significant places where ministry happens and where disciples are made. Our larger United Methodist Church has a lot of layers and connections, but the local congregation is the first place where we learn about following Jesus. It's the church, the body of Christ, that helps us on the journey no matter where we start. And when I say the church, the body, I mean the people. It's people who are disciples of Jesus, who make disciples of Jesus. If you've been part of any congregation, they've helped form you as a disciple of Jesus Christ. People have invested time and energy and money. They've given themselves fully to the mission and ministry of Jesus. No matter whether that's been here or somewhere else, whether it's in a United Methodist Church or another denomination, people have invested their lives, their gifts, for the good of all. Now, I'm a cradle Methodist, which means that I was born into the United Methodist Church. I was baptized when I was 9 months old. I was confirmed in eighth grade and claimed my faith for myself. I went to summer camp at Wesley Woods in Dowling, if anybody knows where that is, near Hastings. I went to Lake Louise in Boyne Falls up north. And that experience, the camping experience, became a formative part of my faith journey. I felt called to ministry when I was in college, where I was involved in our campus ministry there. I went to seminary to study right after that, and so it's fair to say that the church has had a profound influence on my life. And again, I want to be clear when I say the church, I'm talking about the body of Christ. I'm talking about my parents, who made worship and connection a priority, but it didn't end with them. Since I was young, the people, the community of faith, has been a part of my life, and I could tell you all the pastors' names and their particular gifts that impacted me. They were kind and warm. They knew my name. They taught me about Jesus. They're important, but I would say even more important and memorable are the people who fulfilled the vows that they made at my baptism to reflect God's love to me as a child of God, to support my parents in raising me in faith, to nurture me as a disciple of Jesus and affirm God's call on my life and encourage me to think about how God was calling me. They were members of the bell choir that my mom led when I was a little kid, who read to me on their break time. Sunday school teachers who created engaging lessons. People who taught me songs, and those songs taught me faith. People who led vacation Bible school in the summer. Camp counselors who gave up weeks of their time to be with young people at camp. Youth group leaders. Church musicians who invited me to play my instrument with them, people deeply devoted to mission who showed me how to serve, people who showed up in worship to be together. And that's probably just part of the list. But for every person who has and continued to live their faith and encourage mine, I know I need them. And that includes you. You are the church. We are the church together. That's who we are. You are the body of Christ. Tells us in Scripture, you are the body of Christ, all of you. And I hope that you can relate, because the other part is that I know that you need me, not simply as a pastor, but as part of the body of Christ. We need each other. And that message has not changed since Paul wrote it to the church in Rome. One commentator writes, "This passage is not a greeting card slogan, but a call to costly discipleship." And as we think about what it means to live as disciples, this is part of that call. It's about how we treat each other. It's about how we sacrifice for each other. It's about how we humble ourselves with each other. And all of that is vital in our life together. We're part of the whole, and we belong to each other. We have gifts to use, and we should use them to the glory of God. We should not pretend that we have gifts when we don't, or that we don't have gifts when we do. We should be authentic about what it means to follow. It's about personal faith, to be sure, that personal relationship we have with God, but it's also about the responsibility we have to care about each other, to serve, and to care about what God cares about, which is all the world that God has created. And Paul isn't simply offering us a to-do list, but he's describing a lifestyle of how we live every day in response to God's mercy. Growing in faith, living our faith in Christ means that we fight against the desire to conform to the world. If you read the first couple of verses there, Paul talks about being transformed. Be transformed. There are beautiful things in the world, to be sure, but there are many things that aren't the way of God, like fear and hatred and greed, the very opposite of the active love, the sacrificial love and humility that Paul describes. And it's interesting to know the context that Paul wrote to the Romans. Roman Christians were facing a specific issue about how to treat refugees who were returning to Rome. Many of them had been oppressors of the Jewish people, and so there was resentment, which is why Paul addresses how we treat each other, even when there's been conflict. Being transformed in Christ calls us to a higher purpose and a higher response, to forgive and seek peace with one another and to live as those who follow Jesus. Is that easy? Absolutely not. It's very messy. It's very hard. It's very inconvenient. And it's right where we're called to be. And somehow there are moments when we've lost the costly part of what discipleship looks like. It means that we offer ourselves. It means we allow God to transform us from the inside out. It means that we offer the gifts that we have for the building up of the kingdom. And God has built that interdependence into creation. Plants give off oxygen in photosynthesis. You might know that from your basic science class. Humans, animals, we use the oxygen that the plants give off. We give off carbon dioxide. The plants use that for their processes. That's one example of how God has created and ordered this wonderful world. And that interdependence shows in our life together as disciples. We're not alone. We're not called to grow in faith alone. We really can't do it. Everything that we read in Scripture says that we're called to be together to do this. And it's not always easy. These letters to early Christian communities are written to groups of people, to the early church that's been gathered together. Faith isn't lived out in a solitary place. There are times to be alone, to be sure, but we don't live out our faith alone. We can't do this on our own. We need each other. We need each other to find strength. We need each other to build a stronger community of faith. And God brings us together with different gifts to be used for the good of all of us. So Paul reminds the people to see themselves as members of one body and to appreciate the unity they can find in Christ while still celebrating the diversity of the gifts we have. As we consider our faith journey and God's call to use our gifts, there's no room for any false modesty. We're given spiritual gifts for using and building up the body of Christ. We can't deny them. We can't assume that they're for others and refuse to use them. They're for all of us. We're given those gifts so that the body of Christ can be blessed. And just as we think about the power of the community of faith, we're grateful because there are people whose faces and names come to mind who've used their gifts and who've made a difference in ours. Think for a moment about the people that have reflected God's love for you from when you were very young, even until now. Who are the people who continue to use their gifts to encourage you, to inspire you, to reflect God's love, how deep and wide it is for all of us? We celebrate celebrate how deeply we're rooted and how widely God's love reaches when we share it. And as we've gone through this series, I've shared some quotes from Wesley. There are lots of them, but this is one of my favorites, too. I look upon the whole world as my parish. I think Wesley knew the power of the small group. He knew the power of the small group to hold one another accountable. But he also knew the power of what it looked like when those groups of people, those transformed people, went out into the world to share the love of God. It transformed the world. That movement grew into something that he never assumed it would. Because it was important, because it was changing lives. Our roots are deep. Our reach is wide. And I pray the same words for us that we hear in another letter to the Ephesians. It says that being rooted and established in love, we may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. I'm not sure we can totally grasp it, but I like the prayer. It's higher and deeper and wider than we can imagine. It's for all of us to share. And it's really the only way that others know that Jesus loves them too, is by us sharing that love, by using the gifts we have, that the kingdom might come even more today than it did yesterday. Our world is in deep need of it. Deep need of it. So would you join your heart with mine in prayer this morning as we pray for ourselves, as we pray for our loved ones, as we pray for our world in need. Let us pray. Gracious God, in love you created us, and love you sustain us every day. So it's with confidence that we bring our prayers to you, knowing that you hear us, and knowing that you respond in your time, in your will. Hear the prayers of our hearts as we offer them in a moment of silence. God, help us to hold the needs of others as dear to us as our own needs. As we seek to love our neighbors as ourselves, we pray for the world, for those who find themselves held in bondage, enslaved in body, mind, or spirit, oppressed by governments or economic systems. God, hear our prayers. For those who live in the midst of violence and poverty, who watch loved ones die of starvation or malnutrition, of preventable disease, for those who are even now in the midst of war and violence. God, we pray for peace. We pray for help. We pray that you would use us and use the gifts we have to offer it. We pray for those who are seeking justice and who are seeking ways of peace, who are standing up for what is right, and even in the midst of that, dealing with the consequences. God, hear our prayers for peace with justice. We pray for those who are caught in cycles of violence and anger, for those who are part of a system of oppression, for those who can't seem to empathize with others. God, we pray for transformation. We pray for a new way forward in your love. We pray for all who suffer today, physically, emotionally, or spiritually. We pray for safety for those in harm's way. We pray for sanctuary for those who are seeking a safe place. We pray for peace for those caught in the middle. We pray for comfort for broken and grieving hearts. We pray for hope for those who cannot see a future. And God, we pray especially for what we see happening in our world. We pray for peace in the Middle East. We pray for peace in Ukraine. We pray for an end to war and oppression and violence. And we do pray for all those
of the collateral damage of it. God, we pray for your presence to surround and sustain those in our world. And God, we pray for ourselves. We know that we are the body of Christ here in the circles where we have connections, in our families, in our friendships, in our workplaces, in our communities. Break down the barriers that divide us from each other. Unite us in our common allegiance to you as Lord and Savior. Give us compassion and humility in our relationships. Dear God, though we might feel daunted by the grief in our lives and the grief in the world, help us to do justice now and to love kindness now and to walk humbly with you now. We know there's always kingdom work in front of us, and we trust that even small acts that point to your goodness and grace matter. Keep us always ready to respond to the grace that you show us, to never give up on your call, to love you and love others with as much urgency and compassion as you show to us. Help us to use the gifts that you've given to us so that in us and through us your kingdom is always coming into view more clearly. Hear our prayers, O God, as we pray together a prayer in the Spirit of Jesus. Loving Creator, we honor you and we honor all that you have made. Renew the whole world in the image of your love. Give us what we need for today, and give us the hunger to see the whole world fed. Strengthen us for what lies ahead. Forgive our sin. Bring healing from the hurts of the past, and help us to forgive those who have hurt us. Give us courage to follow your call in this moment and always. For your love is the only power, the only hope, the only honor we need in this world and the world to come. Would you stand as you are able, and we'll sing together.
show it as much as we can, that the world might know the love of God, the grace of Christ, the power of the Holy Spirit, the community of the Holy Spirit, to go from here.